Good morning, everybody. This panel specifically is looking at disruptive, about like new technologies that can actually be utilized, for electrification of Africa itself. As you know, 620 million people in Africa is living without electricity. 31% overall and 12.9% in the rural areas. Nigeria specifically, 93 million people without electricity. Ethiopia, 70 million people. The DRC, 60 million people, no electricity. Kenya, 35 million people without electricity. And Uganda, 31 million people without electricity. According to the International Energy Agency, only 30% of the rural areas can be reached with grid extensions. So most can't be connected to the grid. So therefore, we need to look at other solutions. And our panelists will explore that space to find like what other solutions are there, to increase the electrification levels in Africa. What new businesses have been established? What are the challenges that is being faced for those new businesses being established? I'd like to introduce very briefly again the panel. To my left is Thomas from Mobisol. Mobisol already electrified 250,000 individuals in Rwanda, Kenya, and Tanzania. Then we have Simon from Azuri. Simon is also playing in the pay-you-go solar systems in Kenya, Uganda, Ghana, and Ethiopia. Then Mugu Kibati, Mugu, the chairman of Lake Turkana Wind Power, but also the chairman of MCOPA. MCOPA specifically also playing in a pay-as-you-go solar system space. Then we got DHL. DHL, you might all know, but DHL is specifically also playing in the supply chain management space, and also for the supply of electricity from that perspective. And then finally, completely on the left, is Dr. Benan Mutabi. He's the CEO of the Electricity Regulator Authority in Uganda, and he will address as well from a regulator perspective the challenges that are being faced in the increasing electrification level, specifically in Uganda. I'd like to thank the panel members, to take the time to commit to this this panel. And I first like to address the small businesses that have been established, the new and innovative entrepreneurs. You know, what are your successes that you had so far in increasing electrification levels? What are your challenges? And I specifically like to hear some war stories as well, like some examples that you have. And what do you think can be done to increase the electrification quicker and in a sustainable way? So starting off with Thomas.
So you're asking for stories, so I'll take you to East Africa, to Tanzania, and to the third biggest city in Tanzania, Arusha. As soon as you leave the town center of Arusha, if you go 5 kilometers away from the town center, you will find that there's a large number of very decent houses, but there's no electricity because the grid doesn't come there. So the reality of 70 to 80% of people who live in peri-urban and or rural areas is, independently of your level of wealth, there is no electricity. You can put $1 million on the table, you will not get the grid. And that's very frustrating for a lot of people who have an income or different sources of income. So what Mobisol essentially does, we put a solar panel on a roof, which is relatively large. We put a battery in a house. And we bring to the households the set of appliances that they want to use. So what we do, we basically ask a typical household when we started in 2010 and said, what would you want? And they said, we need 5 to 10 lights. We need a TV. we need a radio, we need to recharge mobile phones or laptops, and maybe we want a fridge or an iron. And surprise, surprise, these things work on a solar panel and a battery. So the reality is you can, with something which is decentralized and completely off-grid, and which will probably never come back to the grid, you can do 100% of the electricity needs of a household. And that's something which is quite magic to a household that until now had either to use kerosene lamps. And kerosene lamps is, as you know or may imagine, it's just not a good idea. And if you're wealthy enough, you can buy yourself a generator. But a village with hundreds of generators is just not a good quality of life either. And what we realize with our customers, they don't need an Excel sheet to calculate whether, you know, it's a good return or something. If you don't have electricity, you will want electricity. And if you spend an equivalent amount on a generator, but you can get the same level of quality, or a superior level of quality because it doesn't have noise and it doesn't have fumes, you will take solar. And I think from a more strategic perspective, the success of our industry, all of us together, is to show that you can electrify households with solar. And I think regulators and governments are starting to see that despite the fact that 5 years ago people thought, it's maybe not a serious business, it is a technology that actually does exactly what a household wants. It's cheaper than the grid, it's faster than the grid, and my personal belief is 50 to 70% of rural households in Africa will never see the grid. So we have a solution, we have a huge demand, and I think putting both together is what we aim to do on a daily basis.
And then going to Simon.
I would echo very much what Thomas has just said. When we started Pago Solar about 5 years ago, it was very much about trying to replace kerosene lamps and provide very basic energy supply within the household. And what we've seen over those last 5 years is a really dramatic change, both in terms of the technology available, but also the attitudes of the consumer and the attitudes of government. So 5 years ago, I remember doing a television interview, and we did this long piece about how solar could replace lighting, and it was cheaper than the kerosene it replaced, and so on. And there was an interview from a government minister who effectively said, yeah, well, that's fine, these are just toys, but actually the grid's going to come along fairly soon, and it's going to wipe all this out. This is just a transient industry. Today, I don't think there are very many governments who take that particular view. The technology is moving very rapidly indeed, and in fact, we're seeing now where it's cheaper if you live more than about 500 meters from a grid connection. It's actually cheaper to provide not only the solar power, but all of the appliances that that typical household will use than it is simply to wire up the consumer to the grid. So we're now getting whole areas where it is cheaper to be off-grid than it is physically to connect the customer. Forget about generating electricity, just connecting the customer. And if you look at the direction of travel of those costs, the direction of travel of wiring people up, at very best, is flat. The direction of travel of cost of solar generation and energy-efficient devices is very much down. So the number of people for whom it is cheaper to connect off-grid rather than on-grid is increasing all of the time. When we talk about this, very often people talk about in the terms of electricity generation. But actually, we don't think of it as electricity generation. What we think of it is as service provision to the consumer. The consumer couldn't care less how many kilowatt hours of electricity they have. They care how many hours of light, how much TV can I watch, can I get internet access, can I listen to a radio, can I use a fridge, whatever it may be. And one of the sort of endearing features of the space is that the efficiency or the effectiveness of distributed power is as much to do with the evolution of very low power appliances as it is to do with the evolution of battery technology and solar technology. 10 years ago, a 32-inch TV, assuming you could get one, would take somewhere between 100 and 200 watts. Today, that same TV consumes 12 watts. So we're able to power the TV to the same standard, but with a tenth of the energy that we were previously using. And this brings into question some of the metrics that are used by governments to measure success and progress in terms of electrification. Many governments still talk about how many gigawatt hours or terawatt hours of power have been delivered within a country. But actually, if you don't take into account what that energy is doing, it's pointless. To be able to say that you've got 10 times as much energy to drive an inefficient television as opposed to driving 10 efficient televisions tells you very little about what the end consumer is benefiting from in terms of the power generation. So we need to have a debate within government in particular about how we measure success and what are the various techniques that we're going to use in a blended way, grid, mini-grids, off-grid, and so on, to get that success to consumers as rapidly as possible.
Thanks very much, Simon. Then go to Mughal.
Thank you. Thank you very much. First, let me just say that I agree with Thomas and Simon. I mean, I'm wearing both an off-grid hat here with M-Copper and an on-grid hat with Lake Turkana. And I'm of the view, and I agree with Simon, that we need to change the way we look at the metrics for development. In East Africa, if you go beyond electricity into telecommunications, in fact, I view M-Copper as part of the revolution in East Africa to change livelihoods, transform livelihoods. We have to stop thinking as engineers sometimes, even when dealing with engineering aspects. M-Copper, much like Mobisol, 5 years old, looks at low-income households, both urban as well as rural, that have very little disposable income, about 50 cents to $1 per day used on kerosene, and replacing that with a starter pack from M-Copper that at the end of a year or a couple of years means that particular household and family have had a complete lifestyle change. Where formerly they were on kerosene lamps, students, children were studying on kerosene lamps, they now have proper lamps, TV, radio access without having to spend too much more than they were spending before. So in my view, when you look at the revolution that's taking place in East Africa, which I think is symptomatic of the rest of the continent, the realization that the fusion of technology, demographics, and finance needs to allow us to think differently is what I would have to say about the experience of M-Copper. M-Pesa, for instance, which is in telecommunication industry, you had a telecom company that actually realize that they have to stop thinking as a telecom company and understand what the needs of Kenyans are, and hence M-Pesa, which is a financial service, was born. Similarly, with M-Copper, though initially it was about replacing kerosene lamps, we now see it as a transformative exercise where lives are changed by focusing on the solutions for low-income households in Kenya. And therefore, if you look 5-10 years down the road, it's difficult to predict, if you think linearly, what will an M-Copper be providing? Because when we started, we basically wanted a solar panel to power a few appliances. Now we're thinking, hey, wait a minute. Are we a solar company, or are we a financial services company? Are we a technology company, or are we all? And I think that fusion of those components, once regulators and policymakers understand that it is not a linear technology industry you're dealing with, then I think, and I'm segueing into the challenges, because now you're to talk about challenges. I think one of the challenges we have had is policymakers who do not understand that this fusion of technology, demographics, and finance, and the transformative changes taking place in all three areas and how they're converging, means that solutions for populations in Africa, and I think eventually in the whole world, will not be what we can predict in a linear manner. And therefore, we have a challenge sometimes trying to convince policymakers not to start taxing us too soon, too early stage, and allow the industry to grow and develop and mature and then reap at the end of it all. So now, just very quickly, segueing into the on-grid hat that I wear, electrical wind power. Again, let me say that I believe that in the future, there is room for both on-grid and off-grid. There will always be installations that will lend themselves to on-grid solutions. And there will be, especially when it comes to residential households, solutions that will be more amenable to off-grid solutions. In the case of the Turkana, the only thing I have to say about it is this is a large-scale project in a very remote part of Kenya. In fact, the biggest challenge we had in terms of putting up a 310-megawatt wind power farm, which is still in process as we speak, was a lack of infrastructure. And so to your point, the supply chain was a challenge. And we had actually to construct a road to make sure that we could transport the turbines 200 kilometers from the nearest highway. We had, the government has to construct a 428-kilometer transmission line. But I think the lesson from the Turkana experience is that entrepreneurs, DFIs, governments, private sector can come together to make complex projects and complex technically, logistically, financially, come to fruition in such a remote part if everybody realizes what part they have to play. In this particular case of the Turkana, the DFIs, which are accustomed to aid and grants, in this particular place, play the role of early risk equity, early stage risk equity, de-risking the project to allow commercial equity and commercial players to come in at later stages. And I think this is an example that can be applied elsewhere as well. Thank you.
Thanks. Then going to Steve.
Thank you, Anjali. And thank you, Mugu. You've set that up very nicely for me there by mentioning that project, because I think besides the finance and the technology, there's another critical area, which is the supply chain. And that starts with the planning of a major project, but it can be a major on-grid project like the Turkana project or smaller off-grid projects. Because generally across these projects, you're looking at 20 to 30% of the cost being in the supply chain and the logistics to get them set up. And what we do as a company, besides what everybody knows, perhaps DHL for as envelopes, is our supply chain management. And that can be in maintenance, repair, and operations for existing projects which are already set up, but also as a lead logistics provider, coordinating the various providers who are supporting a project. So a lot of work for us to do in that area, and a critical factor where we need to be at the table from the start of these projects with the objective of making sure that they are efficient and cost-optimized and sustainable. And I think we've seen good examples with the very fast rollout of mobile phone technology across Africa, the speed with which that developed was very impressive. It had good logistics support and, crucially, good long-term maintenance of the system to make sure there isn't too much downtime. And there's no reason why off-grid or on-grid systems cannot have the same success at the same speed, provided there is sufficient support for the supply chain. So that's a role we see ourselves as critically having to play there, but it does need certain conditions. It does need partnership. It does need the recognition that without a long-term agreement, companies like ours are not going to support in very remote rural areas. We need that long-term commitment. And then we're able to train people up. And if we're working across a number of projects, we can optimize the time and the cost benefit for everybody in terms of making sure that people stay on the system. And then, of course, there's the maintenance of the spare part network, the inventories that are required. Where are those inventories kept? How do they get through customs? Inevitably, with 51, 52 countries in Africa, there's very big challenges there in meeting the local regulatory frameworks and making sure that equipment can be brought in quickly and efficiently and costed properly. And that's another role that the supply chain managers can support. And get actively involved in And doing that across a number of providers can reduce the costs. So I think the message there is that there is a challenge around those long-term contracts. There needs to be a position for us to play in that, and that can support the sustainability of projects, whether they're on-grid or off-grid. Thank you.
Thanks, Steve. And then last but not least, the regulator's view on it.
Thank you. These innovative solutions that are being provided by the likes of Mobisol and Mokopa, Azuri, and others are a response to a missing market, because there was a missing market, and this is missing market comes about as a result of a number of people in Africa not having access to electricity. And they came in to provide a solution. At the same time, we have a grid, but how many times is our grid always off? How many hours in a year, in a week, in a day, do we often see our grid not being available? So these solutions came in to bridge that gap. But I would like to admit that as regulators and as a government, we have been a bit slow in responding to those innovations, in quickly integrating these kind of innovations within our overall plans, policy plans of our governments, and recognizing that these solutions are there to play a very significant role. Because given our very nature of our economies, of our countries, we have to admit, if we are going to promote access, if we are going to create universal access for all, I think this solution, these innovative solutions, will become a permanent feature. And these standalone systems, the mini grids and microgrids, will complement the grid in providing electricity to all. So from a regulatory perspective, what our challenge was with these new innovations was, what kind of regulation is necessary for these kind of innovations? What should be the nature of regulation? Whom should we regulate? Whom shouldn't we regulate? And it took us a little bit of time. But of course, they are providing a service. There is a risk on the side of the quality, in as far as the consumer is concerned. There are aspects of safety that need to be regulated, and those need to be thought through carefully so that an appropriate regulatory framework is put in place. But the other very important aspect is, when they come in, which area should they operate in? Who is going to allocate them that area? Should they choose on their own where to go? And what happens when the grid reaches? Those are some of the challenging issues in as far as regulation is concerned and as overall policy is concerned. And I'm happy to say that in as far as these innovative solutions are concerned, I think we now recognize that they are complementary to other solutions. They are complementary to the grid. They will come in. Even when the grid arrives, it's not always the case that they will be displaced. Actually, I think the experience has shown that even when the grid arrives, these solutions will remain active, will remain functional, because our grid has its own challenges, and consumers might prefer, actually, experience has shown that consumers would prefer even to stay with these solutions. But then, when it comes to the issue of the micro and the mini grids, those are pretty important, especially for the business areas, for the business areas that are far away from the main grid. They provide a very important solution, and they need to be regulated. We have to regulate the aspects of quality, the aspects of safety, the aspect of the tariff. And that has been one of our major challenges, the pricing. How do we set the price for these mini grids to be cost reflective? Because of economies of scale, usually the price tended to be very high. So there has to be a carefully designed subsidy policy that is very clear, that is transparent, that everybody knows about, that can support some of these solutions. But I would like to say that going forward, as regulators, as policymakers, we need to recognize the importance of these innovations. We need to support them by way of us as governments coming up with a clear policy framework, on the side of the subsidy, the pricing policy. And on the pricing policy, we need to do it in such a manner that, you know, we are able to unlock the potential of the private participation within this space, because government on its own cannot provide the electricity to all the consumers.
Okay. Thanks, Benon. I heard Thomas would like to react to something being said there as well. So.
Well, I think you made a very, very important point, Benon. You said it becomes a permanent feature. So despite the fact we're talking off-grid, we're talking decentralized, and we're talking solar, it's infrastructure. And I think that's a counterintuitive thing in the beginning. But what it does to households, it's exactly the same or even better than the grid. And infrastructure is something which is long-term. Infrastructure is something which needs to be planned. And in many of the countries in which we work, I cannot look at an electrification strategy that, and the exception is Rwanda, which has very rationally laid out the different electrification options. And there's so much money in the world that is looking at a good investment opportunity. And as Ben said, the demand is there, the offer is there as well. How do we bring things together and understand this part needs to be on-grid? Because I completely agree, there is, of course, a market for off-grid. There is on-grid, there is one for mini-grid and one for off-grid. Because if you ask a household in rural towns, you know, everybody wants electricity. So we have the gap between 30% of people who are electrified and 100%. And I think we can do it in 10 years. There's no need to wait.
Thanks, Thomas.
To another point, not to beat a dead horse, but absolutely, there will be continued demand. And I think this is to the point about nonlinear approach towards the future. Today you have telcos providing financial services, mm-hmm. and you have banks providing technology services. This was never anticipated. It's because initially, and in a way, the problems of Africa, the problems of the developing world, have unearthed solutions, and which I think will eventually be global solutions, frankly speaking. So my view is that if you look at Mobisol or M-Copa, the solutions we provide, grid or no grid, I think a household will want to have the solutions because they are not just, it's not just the power coming in, it's the appliances, which, and it's also total ownership of the power solution into the future. So again, and I think I take to heart the fact that as a policymaker you say that perhaps one has to open wider and anticipate than anticipated in policymaking. Very difficult to do, I think. It's a challenge. I don't blame governments. I have been in government myself. It's very difficult not to think, you know, this is electricity industry, this is telco, this is financial services, and have rules and regulations for them. To ask us to be open-minded as a government is difficult, but that's probably the challenge of government going forward. Thank you.
Yeah. It's okay.
So I think the challenge that many governments face is that this industry is working on a time constant which is short compared to the time constant of thinking of governments. You know, governments find it difficult to do things, make decisions on a timescale of less than 3 to 5 years, and this industry is transforming completely every 2 to 3 years. So while there is absolutely a role for regulation, I would say let's keep the regulation relatively light to begin with, allow the industry to develop, allow the innovation to come, because one thing that governments do really badly is innovate. So we need to let the industry innovate, and then when it becomes clear how things are going to look in the future, then we can apply regulation in order to ensure that things operate in the best possible way.
Okay. I got a question from my side as well to the panelists. All of you are actually from East Africa or working in East Africa. What is the reason for that? Nigeria, like a lot of people, don't have access to electricity. What is there in East Africa that is not in Nigeria, while you... or companies as well from outside Africa, like exploring East Africa. So what is attractive in East Africa that you can't find yet, maybe, in places like Nigeria.
So, I mean, I guess we operate in West Africa as well as in East Africa, so we're, you know, with the government rolling out 100,000 systems in Ghana, we're working in other countries in West Africa. But the reality for us is that the environment in East Africa was just an easier starting point. You had better coverage of mobile money, you had better coverage of mobile phone technology, you had a legal system which was slightly easier to work with, just a variety of relatively small things that made that an easy starting point. But you know, Azuri is in 11 countries across sub-Saharan Africa, so it's not just a case of working in East Africa.
Okay, but you're pointing out there are some things that make it easier to start in East Africa, the mobile money, the mobile phone, the legal type of systems. Anything else from the panelists regarding that?
Yeah, I think from a logistics and supply chain standpoint, there is a need for people to have more trust in outsourcing where the infrastructure exists, which will make it a bit easier to work in some of those West Africa countries where if you can find the service providers to work with you, you don't have to necessarily set up your entire organization yourself there if you can find reliable partners to work with. In our case, we're in, I think, just about every African country, and with varying levels of success. We work there either in partnership or at arm's length with companies who are looking to set up and develop new solutions. And I mentioned earlier about the cell phone developments, which happened across the whole continent very quickly. We played a crucial part in developing that by bringing in the materials which were needed for the towers and making sure there were the right infrastructure developed to support that. So I think it can be done quicker, and it certainly doesn't necessarily have to happen just in East Africa. Yeah.
Ben, are you like to
I agree with my fellow panelists that in as far as East Africa is concerned, and I may not know so much of West Africa, but we have been working so hard in the region to create a very transparent policy and regulatory framework. And I think we have also been working hard to ensure that the investment climate is quite supportive of such an investment. So I'm glad to hear that from the investor point of view, that actually those have been recognized and that we have made some step. I know that there is quite a lot that may still need to be done. I agree with Simon that there is need for light-handed regulation, and that's one of the areas we are working on. We have been working, in the case of Uganda, we are working on light-handed regulation with the GIZ, and very soon we shall come up with light-handed regulation, especially for off-grid and mini-grids. We hope that will help to, you know, to be able to ensure that the various parts of the country can have private operators working in and providing the necessary electricity services. So many Ugandans that have no access to electricity. So, yes, I share the view that we may need as government to provide the necessary support, these innovations initially, but I have to admit that innovations move much faster than policy. So we tend to respond and react later on when the innovators have already moved. And I think that is a fact.
You know, on the issue of why East Africa, it's always dangerous to comment on yourself. I think I would rather have left it to the externals. But I have to say, speaking about Kenya, I think every country, every region, it's a totality of history. Kenya is one of the few African countries that went free market very early on, right from independence, has been a free market country where things such as land and ownership of things, assets, and even company ownership is sort of allowable for allowable to anybody. And with the multi-party democracy fight over the last 30 years, you now have a demographic, people below the age of 35 in Kenya are of the mindset, if it is not explicitly forbidden, then you can do it. And that is how M-Pesa and M-Kopa and all the things, the ICT revolution in Kenya happens. And so that I think is an accumulation of the history of the region, in my view. That's my two cents. And I'll stop right there.
I'd like to come back to this issue mentioned by Ben and investors. Having, you know, a large crowd of investors behind your industry is probably a good idea if you really want to grow. And think back in the year 2000 when the first private equity companies invested in mobile phone technology in Nigeria. Everybody called them crazy because nobody was using a mobile phone in Nigeria, virtually nobody, and it cost you $200 a month. So everybody said, how can it possibly become something that now 150 million people use? And I think this idea of a leapfrog, that there are new types of infrastructure which are lighter, which do better at a lower cost, that's something which is completely revolutionary in the mobile sector. I think you will see a paradigm change in the electricity world as well, where on-grid and off-grid will work together. And you could take any other infrastructure access problem, because a family in a rural village in Tanzania does not have access to decent health infrastructure, doesn't have access to the education it requires, and there are solutions being worked on to actually bring these necessary basic goods and services that will also have a technology play. And I think in the next 5 to 10 years, you'll see an explosion of good solutions which will come not disguised, but, you know, people will not expect the rates of growth that we're about to experience in rural Tanzania, Uganda, Rwanda, whatever.
Okay, I think Thomas mentioned it already a little bit earlier as well. Thomas thinks, I think you said, within 10 years, everybody in Africa can have access to electricity. We have the United Nations 2030 target to have Africa electrified, but I'd like to hear from the other panel members as well. How do you see that? Within how many years do you think with these new type of companies, innovative technologies, how long do you think we need to electrify Africa? Any ideas?
Well, let me go first. I think for me, the year 2030 is a magic year. Not because of anything that we can foresee, but I think because of the innovations that are taking place and the focus on solutions. I think what has changed over the last 10 years in Africa is that people have begun to look at developing world problems and challenges and began to deliver solutions which are unique to them, hence the leapfrogging we're talking about, hence M-Pesa. So for instance, mobile money, even when eventually you have a mature, sophisticated financial system in Kenya, for instance, where you have credit cards, and mobile money will still be king because the convenience of it is so powerful. But that was a solution that was developed because of a problem that was uniquely Africa, so to speak. And so because of this, I see by 2030, I think a combination of the on-grid and innovative off-grid solutions, and who knows what other innovation. I would be hard-pressed to believe that whether it would be a rural household or an urban household, in most parts of Africa, by 2030, they'll have access to power and what comes with electricity, the appliances and the amenities and conveniences that come with that. That's my view.
Okay. Any other reactions?
Well, I may not be in a position to pin down a specific time frame, but I think the levels of innovation today are really doing something wonderful and far beyond sometimes our expectations. If you look at the rate of decrease in the solar prices of solar panels over the last 5 to 8 years, I don't think all of us could have imagined that. And I'm one of those people who keep on praying that the same happens to storage, you know. And once that happens to storage, and I honestly can see that. Like my colleague has said, by 2030, 2040, there, around there, probably.
Around there, sorry.
By 20, 2030, 2040, probably even if it will not be universal access, but at least I would expect to see 80% of African households having access to some form of clean energy. But all depends on what's happening on the innovation space. So if the innovations can be remain supported and that drastic reduction in prices and new innovations, yes, I think we shall be there.
Yeah, I would agree with that. I think it's critical that the cost factor is focused on strongly. The costs have to go down, not just on the panels, but as I said earlier, on the distribution costs and the distribution networks. For people to be able to buy materials, it's critical that the distribution networks improve, and they are improving very quickly now. And that's going to make a big difference to people being able to get access to things which they can afford. So I would agree with that sort of timetable as well.
I think from our perspective, we would say this is actually not a technical problem. The technology exists today. There will be more innovation, but there's actually no need for it. I don't believe that we're going to have universal electrification by 2030. I think we're going to have patchy electrification. I think some countries will go much faster than other countries. And it's really about organization. It's about, can governments, finance, and the environment come together to go and deliver that universal electrification within a given country. The technology is here today, the financing principle is here today, but there's a whole load of things that need to be knitted together with government policy to make it happen, and some countries will do it and some countries won't, in my view.
Okay, then I'd like to open up the discussion for the public for questions. I see in the front on the left there. I don't know where the microphone is. Yeah.
Well, thank you very much for a very, very inspiring discourse on...
If you can briefly introduce yourself and the company you're from.
Oh, my name is Ruel Khoza. I'm from South Africa. I'm currently chairman of Globlack, which is funded by the CDC and no fund, and focuses on renewables. But I was just appreciating the conversation on this innovation, but during the course of it, no mention was made of DFIs such as Power Africa. Is it because the innovation is so intrinsically powerful and robust, it's self-propelling, it needs no crutches? Or do you see any point of interface with those kinds of facilitators?
So, Power Africa, because you just mentioned it, I think we're all in very, very, very deep and almost daily contact with Power Africa. Power Africa is basically one of our platforms where we can present what we innovate. And just to give you one example of how we interact with Power Africa, in December last year, we were challenged by Andy Herskovitz, who's running Power Africa, and he said, it's all nice, you're doing, you know, things for households, but you cannot power businesses. And in particular, this solar thing will never work on a welding machine. So I said, okay, that's a challenge. So I went back to Berlin, talked to our engineers and said, guys, can you have a welding machine working on solar? And they said, that's a challenge. Today, we have one, you know. 9 months later, we have a welding machine that actually works. And we had Andy Herskovitz come to see it work in Tanzania. And that's the kind of ping-pong game or interaction or iteration between people that actually will give us an innovation challenge and actually a team of engineers developing the hardware that goes with it.
Any other questions? I see in the back there. If you can briefly introduce yourself. If you have a microphone.
Chris Cook, Senior Research Fellow at University College London, the Institute for Security and Resilience Studies. I used to be a director of what is now the biggest global energy exchange. And I've heard very interesting talk in the last couple of days. I was a regulator myself. looking at the evolution from energy as a commodity, which it clearly isn't, not for electricity anyway, to electricity as a service. Now, I was talking yesterday at a very high-level meeting in relation to the regulation and the development of a regulatory structure and instruments, because you need both, which is fit for the 21st century. Any reactions to this from the panel? My own personal instinct as a former designer of instruments, financially, I designed the UK's natural gas futures contract, so I apologise for that. But how about energy credits? For me, this is the answer, that if producers can issue credits which they will then accept in payment for their services, it's game over. Thank you.
Okay, it's not a question. I thought maybe from a regulator perspective on energy credits to accept for energy as a service. Do you have any ideas on that, Ben? Or any of the other panelists? That
I didn't get the question clearly, but what I really think is that where I absolutely agree with him is that the regulatory framework must always constantly design new regulatory instruments to respond to new issues, new innovations, new markets. It cannot be a standard and static regulatory framework. We have to be, you know, also allow our regulatory instruments to evolve and to be able to respond to new markets, new features. So I agree with him on that one.
I guess I've got to almost answer the question with a question. So imagine that you've got satellite TV in the middle of nowhere in a country in Africa. Is that an energy service? Is that lease provision? Or is that provision as content as a service? it's clearly a mixture of all of them. And I think we need to think much more broadly than just saying energy is the answer and, oh, by the way, you plug in this thing. You're providing an end-to-end service, and energy is a component part. It's a very important component part, but it's by no means the only part of that. So it's really about delivering end service provision to the consumer rather than delivering energy as a commodity.
Okay, a question in front of here.
I'm Sandro Clerici from Chiesi, Italy. We are involved in a lot of studies for electrification of villages, and we believe the mini-grid is one solution, but there is not a single bulb. We have seen if you have even some hundreds of kilometers, a cheap production may be the cheapest option to be analyzed. So I would like to know if someone of you have been investigating that. The cost of transmission lines in Africa are less than one half of what they are in Europe. You involve the people on that because I believe and it's very important to involve for a social development the people. And also in the mini grid, I believe, is as I've said before, is by far better than to have a single panel in a single home. That is the most expensive solution, that not scalable, because if you want, you have to add a panel, you have to add an inverter. You cannot have also the use of motors for pumping and so on, because do you know a motor, if you start that, you need seven times the power of the motor to start. So I would say every case, as someone of you has said, should examine a series of different solutions without disregarding the possible connection to a network, and for having reliability, taking care that the cost of high-speed diesel is very low. If you use them for a few hours when you make maintenance to the line, may be one of the solutions.
Okay. And your question is to the panel?
Also, this possibility just not to look at ideology of only a mini grid that has also supply from a far system, even some 100 of kilometers, if it is cheap there, the energy.
Okay, so I think the question is, are you actually exploring, and maybe that's something more from a regulated perspective, because I know the companies are, when do you do something with a mini grid? When do you do grid extensions? When do you do small home solar systems based on a cost analysis?
I think we all agree that there is a game to be played in on-grid, in mini-grid, and in solar home system off-grid. And I don't think there's one that's necessarily better or worse. I just see there's a huge dynamic in our sector. We're just growing like crazy. Mini-grids have been talked about for 5 years, and you know the economics of mini-grid. It works great on paper. When it actually comes to implementing and calibrating a mini-grid, in particular when it comes to scalability, it's not quite that easy. And investors know that, and people who spend 24 hours a day doing mini-grids know it's harder than we thought it would be. So there's no point in actually starting a competition amongst ourselves. We have 70% or 80% of rural populations that are waiting for electricity. So where mini-grids can be successful, go ahead where you can find investors and actually a demand where people can actually pay for that. Go ahead, there's enough space for everybody. But please don't start, a head competition, because it doesn't make any sense.
I think, why would you want a mini-grid? You want a mini-grid because there are some economies of scale of being able to wire up different consumers, and so you can get some energy being used in a more concentrated way in one place and in a more concentrated way in another place. And I sometimes use the example of my kitchen at home. So in my kitchen at home, I have probably 20 devices, and they all have their own power supplies, and they all generate their own electricity. And it would be much more efficient if there was just one power supply in my kitchen which drove all those various devices. But that would make no sense at all, because I would lose the flexibility of being able to have other devices that I could plug in wherever I wanted. So the trade-off between a mini-grid and standalone power is really the trade-off between what economies of scale can you get by bringing units together and sharing power again between them, versus the cost of being able to do all of that management and wiring up those various devices. And I think, as Thomas said, there is an overwhelming case for the grid itself in high-density urban areas. There is an overwhelming case for off-grid solutions in low-density areas. Frankly, the case for mini-grids is still unproven. As Thomas says, it works great on paper, but actually if you look at the number of mini-grids that are out there today, they are pitifully few. So that does suggest that there are some issues there that still need to be dealt with.
And if I can add a last point, you mentioned, big machines that require more power than solar. And if you take the example of a rice husker, a machine that is needed in agriculture all over Africa and all over the world, currently, a rice husker is 1 kilowatt and more. So you cannot power it on solar, I agree. I've been shown 4 months ago a rice husker that's 55 watt hours. And that actually, of course, doesn't do what the big one does, but is perfectly suitable for a small scale rice farmer. It's a direct current device. It doesn't require an inverter. And what I see happening at the level of the industry that produce appliances, also for the productive areas, so small businesses and agriculture, they see that there's a couple of 100,000 solar systems out there, and they start producing machines that don't require 7 times the power that we can do. They build machines that actually work together with solar. And I think there's an appliance revolution happening right now, which will make the case of a single panel stronger, simply because technologically it can do things it couldn't do 5 years ago.
Just to make a comment on not choosing one or the other, because I think there's two elements. There's the fact that, and as I said earlier, you'll always have a space for me for a long time for off-grid, on-grid, for different types of solutions. But just to Simon's point, sometimes efficiency comes up strongly against lifestyle choices. No matter what you do about us human beings, you talk about efficiency. We hate efficiency. If you look at one of the reasons why the grid has been a challenge in countries like Kenya is because of the dispersed ways that we live. You know, we have cultural ways of living. You know, we don't have concentrated, villagized dwellings. We have people who divide their farms to their sons and their grandchildren, and you have people living all over the place in a very dispersed manner. And no matter how much you talk efficiency, it's politically infeasible to do it. And that's not the same as a kitchen, but it's a similar mentality. And we have lifestyle choices as human beings that come up against efficiency. So the combination of all that forces all types of solutions. But innovation from every end, the energy supplier, the appliance manufacturers. And this is why I keep saying that to anticipate 10 years from now what the solutions will look like is something that we can, you know, try have some fun doing. But really, regulation policy should follow innovation.
Okay. What? Back to the regulator, Bernard.
From out of experience, what I seem to have noticed is that for places like islands, concentrated homesteads, and where you have some bit of business activity taking place, mini grids seem to be a more viable option as opposed to standalone systems. However, my colleagues here on the panel have indicated, in a number of these countries, you have people that are living in a manner that they are not close to each other, very far from each other, and sometimes in the difficult-to-reach areas. And that is the characteristic of some of these African countries, and we have to admit that. So in planning the best solution, that needs to be looked at. Now, it is said that mini grids have been more on paper than the reality. I partially tend to agree, but I also would like to take part of the responsibility to us as regulators and also as government, because a mini grid developer would want to have a concession contract with government before he can invest. And there are still issues of who is responsible for the grid. As long as government has not come out clearly to define who is responsible for the construction of this grid, under what standards should this grid be constructed? What happens to the future of this grid if the main grid was ever to reach? Then the financing of such a mini grid becomes very difficult. So the difference between these kind of solutions and the mini grid approach is that for the mini grid developer is negotiating with government institutions for a contract, for a binding contract. And in the case of these solutions of Mukopa and Azura and others, they are not negotiating with government. They're actually negotiating with the consumer. As long as the consumer is happy with the solution, it works tomorrow. And that's where the difference lies. Yep. So the mini grid is a quite slower process because it involves negotiating a binding contract with government. But I think mini grids have their own advantages as well, depending on the nature of the homesteads, depending on the nature of the business activity in the area. And we need to promote them, we need to support them, I think, as governments and regulators.
But I still think we need to talk, you know, if it's not at a negotiation level, at an informal level, because the reality is when we have installed 500 systems in a village, there's probably no need for the grid anymore, simply because, as you said yourself, grids don't always work. A solar system always works. It's 100% of the time. So there is, I think, and because it's infrastructure, and infrastructure is a long-term planning process, we need to put all the people at a table that actually have a stake in that. It's investors, it's governments, it's regional governments, and it's the people actually doing it to make sure that we coordinate our efforts together with mini grids and whatnot to make sure we don't do, you know, the same stuff in the same area.
Okay, one more question from the public. I see in front here. You can briefly introduce yourself and keep the question short.
Yeah, sorry, I keep it short by not reintroducing myself. When I asked the first question, one of the questions I wanted to ask but was a little bit shy to was where cellular telephony or telephony and conventional telephony are concerned, what revolutionized telephony was doing away with wires. Do you, in your wildest dream, envisage a wireless grid?
That's an interesting question. Does anybody want to react on that? Wireless grids.
Well, I'm not an engineer, but what we do, we substitute the grid. So we do, from a household perspective, exactly what the grid would have brought to you, and we don't have wires. So it's not in my wildest dreams, it's here today.
Any further reactions?
Yeah, I mean, so there will be a wired grid and there will be an unwired grid, just as there is a wired internet and an unwired internet. So you know, there is no such thing as a mobile internet. That the mobile internet is wired right the way down to the end tower, and the very last little bit is unwired. So you know, there's a mixture of the two. But certainly there will be regions where you have a virtual grid where each household has its own power generation, but there is no physical connection between them.
Okay. And I would like to ask the panel members just what were your main takeaways now from this discussion? Keep it very short, starting maybe with Benin.
Thank you. What clearly comes out of this discussion is that these innovative solutions that are coming are quite extremely important, and they need to be supported by governments, they need to be supported by the regulators, and that there is a need for coordination as we plan in our planning, so that it's very clear where this solution should work or where other solutions should work, so that there is no duplication of efforts and we do not frustrate the investors. I think that's really what comes out for me out of this discussion.
Steve?
Yeah, I think the what's clear from this is the speed of the discussions and the innovations that are going on. Clearly, there's going to be a lot of change in the next 5 to 10 years, and that's going to involve all of the different parties that we've talked about now, from regulatory through to the technical and through to the logistics side of this, becomes very important. But I think underlying all this, there needs to be a focus on what is the best for developing what are very underdeveloped parts of the world. So are standalone systems really going to serve in 2030 or 40 for the needs of developing villages and towns that are going to need a lot of more infrastructure, more public infrastructure. So lots of discussion to be had, I think, but at the same time, everything can now move on very, very much quicker than it has done in the last 20 years.
If I just pick up on that last point, what villages will need in 2030, whether, you know, the on-grid or the off-grid, the question I have is, do we know what off-grid will look like in 2030? I am actually loath to say, you know, because I agree, if you take what Thomas was talking about, you know, a lot of appliances or heavy-duty equipment today cannot run on solar. But the innovations on both ends, you know, on the solar end and on the appliance end, the lifestyle changes, demographics. Today, in every sector that I'm involved in, I find consumers, especially young consumers, don't have the traditional expectations of receiving services from a particular traditional provider. So they don't expect that financial services come from a banker, and therefore energy services also will, I think, evolve similarly. So my takeaway from this is light-hearted regulation, and I'm glad the regulator agrees that innovation has to be ahead, or regulation has to follow and not stifle innovation. And I also think that 10 years down the road, it's difficult to anticipate or predict what some of the terms we're using today as off-grid and on-grid will reference 10 years down the road. And that's a good thing, because the focus more and more now is on providing tailored solutions for the citizens of the world. And that's what excites me about what's happening today in innovation.
Thank you.
Yeah, I think my takeaway is 10 years ago, energy provision was completely top-down. What we're now seeing is energy and service provision appearing bottom-up, and the two are going to meet, and the boundary between the two is moving upwards very rapidly. And it's really incumbent on governments and other environments to provide the enabling framework, to provide the grid wherever the grid can be provided, but also to provide the flexibility to allow the commercial sector to do its thing bottom up, and then we'll find what the best solution is for the consumer.
My takeaway is we need to work together. We seem to have reached, the industry has reached a state of materiality where governments start to realize, oh, it's not a toy, it's real infrastructure. We have very powerful investors behind us, and I think rather than competing against each other, which we tend to do in our markets, why don't we, you know, join forces together with investors and go to talk to regulators, ministers of energy, ministers of infrastructure, ministers of budget, and say, look, this is what we can do within 4 to 10 years, and then this is what it will cost you. And that can then be compared to the cost of maybe on-grid or other infrastructure. And I think we need a big push and bring people to the table to really make something visionary in the next 10 years. And if we're done by 2030, I'll be happy to retire.
So what we can really see is like the industry is really transforming. There's an enormous amount of innovation taking place. We can really leapfrog because of the technology that's changing so fast. But what we really need to do is we need to work more together. We need to make sure that that governments, that regulators, and that new players in the industry work more together to ensure that there is an enabling environment to be able to leapfrog due to all this innovation that is taking place. There will be electricity for all. I think that can be a conclusion from this panel based on a discussion that we had as well. According to Thomas, within 10 years, according to the others, maybe a little bit later. But the most important thing is really, you know, to work together to get it done. And in the end, the consumer is king. It's not about electricity, but it is about what can the consumer do with it? What does the consumer need? And how can we provide that? I'd like to thank the panel members for all the contributions and also the audience for the questions. Thank you very much.